people. Real crimes. Real life drama.
This is a murder case that began with a nightmare and a woman who had visions of violence.
To me, it was a dream. I woke up and it just startled me. I usually have very strange dreams. When I wake up in the morning, I remember bits and pieces, and within half an hour, it's completely gone. I said, I'm worried about Kelly. I think Kelly's hurt.
Kelly Brenner was a nurse at one of the local hospitals. We all thought of it, the hospital.
Kelly was beautiful. When she came in the room, it was like glamorous. She was patient-oriented, wasn't afraid to take charge. We called her the Sarge.
Well, tell me what happened. What did you dream about Kelly?
Everything was black, and she was arguing with somebody, and I saw the sign for Mark's Landing.
On February 15th, 2010, Kelly Brennan went missing.
She didn't show up for work. It was like an unsettling panic that we didn't know what would happen to Kelly.
Something was not right. It was not adding up, and that's why we called the police.
911, what's the problem there?
I think there's been a murder.
We sent people down to start to look at Mark's Landing and in that area to see if they could find Kelly and actually put an aviation unit up in the air. A helicopter had spotted what they believed to be a person laying in the wooded area. Shortly later, we were able to identify that it was Kelly Brown.
You can follow me, Peter, right back in here toward the shrub.
Wow, back in the bush.
And this is where Kelly ended her life.
Right here.
Most of the injuries are directed direct at her head.
So there's a frenzied attack with many blows being struck.
There's a lot of anger and rage in that.
Once the body's found and it's where she says it is.
Mark's Landing. I said, I can see Mark's Landing.
Of course, then she becomes your prime suspect.
In the dream, it's just like I told them, she was arguing with somebody.
My name is Todd Derritani. I was a criminal defense lawyer, and one day, Sheila Trott came into my office and told me that she was accused of murder. Sheila was trying to convey to me that she didn't commit any murder, and that she merely had a dream, a vision about this that came to her, like she was clairvoyant.
If it hadn't been for me, they wouldn't have gone to Mark's Landing looking for her. I told the truth, and I'm continuing to tell the truth. I did not kill Kelly Brennan.
You don't believe that she has some supernatural ability, that all these facts came to her in a dream?
No, I don't think she's clairvoyant. I think she's a killer.
I'm Peter Van Sant. Tonight, on 48 Hours,
A Vision of Murder.
We'll be back in 90 seconds.
It's hard to imagine this picturesque seashore, Mark's Landing on Florida's Space Coast, as a beachside grave.
Where Kelly Brennan was lying on the ground?
He noticed her legs sticking out from the bushes a little bit, kind of the lower part of her torso.
It was on the morning of February 16th, 2010, that chopper pilot John Kukla of the Brevard County Sheriff's Department spotted a body.
We landed, I got out of the helicopter, ran over to her.
I saw a lot of trauma to her head. It's a very sad moment to see somebody dead like that.
It was 46-year-old Kelly Brennan, who had vanished from her home in Indian Atlantic less than 24 hours earlier.
There was no saving Kelly Brennan.
No, unfortunately, no. There was no saving her.
She was so alive. She was always, you know, running around doing things, and then to know that she was dead. It was just a total shock.
Lou Irvasi and Kelly were close friends and nurses at a local hospital. They often kayaked together.
When you think about Kelly Brennan, what do you miss the most?
Her friendship, working with her was good because she is a good nurse. She knew her stuff, but also just as a friend.
Kelly was committed to her patients even after she was diagnosed with an incurable disease, multiple sclerosis.
It would flare up at times, and she would just keep working and work right through it, which was another thing I admired about her.
Sheila Trott, the woman at the center of this murder, says Kelly Brennan was her friend as well.
What is it about her that you liked?
We had the type of friendship where we wouldn't see each other for 4 or 5 years, and then something would bring us together. She hosted parties. She liked to be the center of attention. Kelly was a great girl. There was nothing that she did to deserve that at all.
So how did it come to this? Sheila Trott, suspected of brutally murdering her friend and dumping her body right here among these bushes. Well, it's a complicated tale of secrets, lies, and intrigue. A story that begins with an eerie dream and ends like a Shakespearean tragedy.
Does this case have an affair?
Yes.
Sex?
Sure.
Jealousy?
On both sides.
Major Todd Goodyear is the lead investigator.
And a nightmare and visions and who knows what?
Clairvoyance. Of course, that's our suspect saying that she's clairvoyant. For us, that's somebody that's trying to live with what they've done.
I woke up and it just startled me. And I said, I'm worried about Kelly. I think Kelly's hurt.
In this dream, was Kelly Brennan dead? Mm-mm. Did you see her bloodied?
No. Mm-mm.
Did you see her body
no.
at Mark's landing?
No.
You did not kill Kelly?
No. No, I would never have hurt Kelly. No, I never would have hurt Kelly.
But to truly understand just how strange this story is, you have to go back in time, 20 years. Kelly Brennan, a nursing student, and Sheila Trott were friends. Sheila was working 3 jobs to put her husband, Daniel, through flight school.
Dan was an upwardly mobile kind of guy, liked the limelight a little bit. Some of the things we heard was he a little narcissistic, one of those people that liked to believe he had a little more power and a little more status.
She was head over heels.
Allison Bartlett remembers when her best friend Sheila fell for the tall, handsome, aspiring pilot.
I never heard or saw that spark in her that I did when she talked about Dan and sent photos of Dan, and I could see that they were going to be getting married.
And what did she tell you about his personality?
Fun, liked the same things that she did. I think in a lot of ways she found a soulmate.
At least she thought she did.
At least she thought she did.
Sheila and Dan were married on August 26, 1989. The couple had 2 sons, Creighton and Graham. Sheila became a real estate agent, and Daniel Trott achieved his dream of becoming an airline pilot. In 2002, his political career also took off when he was elected mayor of their small town in the Atlantic.
Based on your investigation, were Dan and Sheila Trott considered a power couple in the Atlantic?
I think within town, because of his status as being, formally into political circles there, and her being a real estate agent, them being fairly well-to-do, I think they were in that social circle where they would be well-known throughout the community.
From the outside, Sheila and Dan seem to have the perfect life. But images can be deceiving.
What did you see in his behavior? What happened?
He began having affairs. I would notice his ring was on the counter. He wasn't wearing his ring. And then when I would say, look, we need to talk, what's going on, he would swear and cuss at me.
That's Sheila's story. 48 Hours reached out to Dan Trott about these allegations, but he refused to comment. By January 2009, Sheila had had enough.
So you asked for the divorce?
Oh, absolutely, yes. I said, I'm done.
While her marriage was crumbling, Sheila and Kelly met for a girls' night out. And it wasn't long before Sheila realized that Kelly's 6-year marriage to restaurant manager Gino Rallo was on the rocks, too.
She had made a point of saying that she wouldn't care if Gino had an affair, which I thought was a really strange thing to say.
Dan Trott moved out and joined a cycling group where Kelly Brennan was a member. And soon, they were going out on more than long bike rides.
Dan and Kelly were both lying to everybody, saying that they weren't having an affair. And while this whole thing was going on, I was having my problems with Dan. He was just being very belligerent.
Sheila's mother repeated to investigators her daughter's claims of other affairs. But Major Goodyear says it was Dan's admitted relationship with Kelly that led to murder.
She's going to lose Dan. I'm going to kill the thing that he now loves. Or I'm going to take that away and I'm going to hurt him as bad as he's hurt me. And then you get the third thing. If I can't have him, nobody's going to have him.
You've been portrayed as being obsessed with Dan.
You laugh. You're saying that's not true.
Oh, no. I'm sure he wishes I was obsessed with him. No, absolutely not.
You couldn't bear the thought of losing him. You couldn't bear the thought of him with another woman.
Oh, no. Well, the fact that I set him up with Kelly would, that would be a little different, but...
With Kelly Brennan?
Yes, absolutely.
You set them up?
Yes, absolutely.
Wait a second.
Yeah, she was my ticket out of a bad marriage.
But police aren't buying one word of Sheila's story, and they want to question her about Kelly Brennan's murder.
God's honest truth, if I was going to kill anybody for any reason, it would have been him.
That's the place that she loves. That's where her heart is, right there.
Sheila Trott had a lifelong love affair with the water.
Yeah, I should have been born with gills, I suppose.
Long before she was accused of murder, she spent carefree summers on this picturesque Canadian island.
So this is where she learned to swim, and this was her favorite place in the whole world.
Margaret Byers says her daughter doesn't belong at the center of this murder investigation, but back with her family in Canada.
Sheila used to just love to run through these rocks. If she could see this right now, she would just be in tears. This is where she belongs.
It was Sheila's love of the water that drew her to live on the Florida coast, where she was a diving instructor and went to college. Now, she swims in a sea of suspicion.
I did not kill Kelly Brennan. She was the best thing that could have ever happened to me.
In fact, Sheila says she orchestrated the relationship between Dan and Kelly one night over dinner to speed up her own divorce.
So I said to her, I said, you know something, Kelly? I said, you and Dan would be great for each other. And she just perked up and she said, really? And I said, yeah. I said, but Kelly, you're going to have to lose weight.
But prosecutor Samantha Barrett says Sheila is making up the matchmaker story. Barrett says that Sheila was simmering with anger and jealousy over the relationship. Anger that finally boiled over when she savagely killed Kelly on this lawn right behind me.
It was horrific. She was lying in wait for Kelly when Kelly came out of her house. I believe once she started the attack and she knew Kelly wasn't going to be able to fight back, that's when the rage came to the surface.
Authorities begin building a timeline that prosecutor Jim McMaster says started on the night of February 15th, 2010, when Kelly misses an appointment with her personal trainer.
And they couldn't find her. Couldn't contact her, couldn't find her.
Kelly's roommate files a missing persons report 2 hours later.
They checked every police department, every hospital, fire rescue, highway patrol. They went to her residence and were clueless as to where Kelly Brennan was.
Meanwhile, according to her sons Graham and Creighton, Sheila arrives home after a four-hour trip to Walmart. She was dizzy, shaking, and acting strangely.
Fire rescue with address the emergency.
So her son's girlfriend calls 911.
The paramedics arrived. They couldn't find anything physically wrong with her, so they left.
An hour later, another call to 911.
My boyfriend's mom just had a seizure about an hour ago, and they said to call back if she's been acting weird or anything, and she's acting very strange.
She was then transported to the hospital, and they ran routine tests, and nothing of medical significance was identified. She was released from the hospital and came home.
When they return from the hospital in the wee hours of the morning, Sheila begins talking about the dream.
She called her younger son, Graham, into the bedroom. She told him she had a bad dream. She kept seeing Kelly's face in the dark and that she believed that she hurt Kelly.
Worried, Sheila's sons telephoned their grandmother.
Graham just said to me, Margaret, we need you. We need you.
She drives from her Florida condo to Sheila's house, where she finds her daughter curled up in a fetal position on her bed.
She was shaking from head to toe, and she said, call the police. I said, what happened? She said, Mom, everything's black. Everything's black, and all I can see is Kelly's face. It was Graham that said to me, Margaret, I think Mom's killed Kelly.
Fearing her daughter was having a nervous breakdown, Margaret Byers makes yet another 911 call.
We just need a policeman, please. What's the problem there, please?
This call would change Sheila's life forever.
I think there's been a murder. My daughter has had a nervous breakdown, and she's saying she's killed somebody.
Your daughter's telling you she killed somebody?
Yes.
Right. She didn't tell you who she's saying she killed?
She's saying she, I don't know.
Kelly, did she tell you where this happened?
It's down Mark's Landing.
Mark's Landing?
It's sort of the defendant's own words through her mother and through her sons. I mean, she's basically confessing to the crime in the 911 call.
After that explosive call, officers rush to Sheila Trott's home, and she continues rambling about the dream.
She's making some statements, I believe I hurt someone. I keep seeing Kelly's face, to the point that the Atlantic police believe we may have a homicide on our hands.
Then, detectives put two and two together.
Wait a minute, we had a missing person report last night of Kelly Brennan.
And when you make that connection, what are you thinking?
You're talking to the killer.
That's when Kelly's body is spotted from the air, and cops on the ground rush to Mark's Landing.
Detectives have been at this in the Atlantic home for some time, all after the body of 46-year-old Kelly Brennan was found 10 miles away in this same area.
Kelly's body was found exactly where Sheila dreamt it would be. And so, less than 2 days after Kelly Brennan disappeared, Sheila Trott is arrested for murder.
I'm going to be in jail for a very long time, okay?
Sheila Trott calls her son, Creighton.
They're charging me with first-degree murder.
She says, but it's not true. I didn't do it.
Sheila hires defense attorney Todd Derritany. And even though that dream led to Kelly's body, Derritany insists the prosecution's case isn't so ironclad.
The police didn't have DNA, they didn't have fingerprints, witnesses, and they didn't have any blood that matched to Sheila Trott. Looks like you've got, at a minimum, a case of reasonable doubt. Absolutely reasonable doubt. It's a dream case.
So little physical evidence, prosecutors say, because Sheila Trott planned it that way.
It's not like she all of a sudden found out that Kelly was having an affair with Dan Trott and then confronted her immediately and beat her to death. She'd known this had been going on for months and months and months, and she planned it down to the last detail. She's a murderer.
Do you believe Sheila dreamt about the murder? Chat now on Twitter and Facebook.
Breakdown and she's saying she's killed somebody.
Did you kill Kelly?
No, I didn't kill Kelly Brennan. Absolutely not.
Sheila Trott remains behind bars for 4.5 years awaiting trial for the brutal murder of her friend, Kelly Brennan.
She said, all I want to do is hug my boys. And I understand that, because all I want to do is hug my girl.
Today you absolutely believe in your daughter's innocence, correct?
Absolutely. 110%.
As the trial finally begins in September of 2014,
to order, please,
investigators believe they've built a strong but admittedly circumstantial case, beginning with that bizarre dream.
The defendant began saying that she had a dream that she may have hurt Kelly and that it happened at Mark's Landing.
Do you have an eyewitness to this murder?
No.
Do you have a murder weapon?
No.
Do you have Sheila Trott's DNA on Kelly Brennan?
No, I don't believe so.
But Major Todd Goodyear does have a theory of the murder based on blood stains and divots in the grass in front of Kelly's home.
Peter, this is the house where we believe that Sheila Trott laid in wait, waited for Kelly Brennan to come out to her vehicle, snuck up behind her at nightfall, hit her in the back of the head, and then continued to hit her in the head multiple times with some type of object. We believe a hammer.
Goodyear believes Sheila then put Kelly's body inside Kelly's own SUV, where CSIs found her blood on the passenger side floor. He says Sheila then drove Kelly's SUV to Mark's Landing, where she dumped the body. Then, she abandoned the SUV at a nearby condo.
What kind of a murderer could I have been that I didn't leave fingerprints? I didn't leave hair. I had no bruises, I had no broken nails, no cuts on me or anything like this. Nothing connects me to this crime whatsoever.
This was not a physical fight. This was an ambush where she bashed in this woman's brains with a hammer. She probably didn't have to break a nail to do that. What the lack of physical evidence means to me is how premeditated the crime actually was.
Defense attorney Todd Derritany couldn't wait to bring this case to trial.
I was absolutely certain that this was 80% chance I could have won this case. Working at half speed, it was that good of a case.
But as the trial begins, Derritany won't be able to show how good a case he thought he had. He's nowhere near the courtroom.
You looking for 4x4 or 2-wheel drive?
He's selling used cars across town at a dealership he now owns,
Big Boy Motors.
He has had his own legal troubles. Florida State Supreme Court has permanently disbarred him for harming clients by taking their money and then failing to represent them. So while Derritini's counting the cash from his car business, Sheila is fighting for her freedom. The prosecution plays that damning 911 call from Sheila's mother.
She didn't tell you who she's saying she killed?
I don't know.
Kevin. Did she tell you where this happened?
Mark Landy?
The man at the center of this alleged love triangle takes the stand.
My name is Daniel Trott. Last name spelled T-R-O-T-T.
It's Sheila's husband and Kelly's boyfriend at the time of the murder. Clearly annoyed, Dan Trott wishes he could be anywhere but here.
Do you recall the date of February 15th of 2010?
Yeah.
You have a specific memory about that day?
I've been spending nearly the last 5 years trying to forget it, but yes, I suppose I remember a few things.
Prosecutors need to establish Dan's affair with Kelly as the motive which pushed Sheila to kill.
You're looking forward to seeing her that evening?
Absolutely. Very much so.
Sheila's new attorneys, public defenders, see an opening. They use Dan Trott to point the finger at a man they believe had the strongest motive to kill Kelly, her jealous husband, Gino Rallo, who reacted with violence when he learned of the affair.
He physically shows up at your house and confronts you.
He physically broke through the door and came up and essentially assaulted me, yes.
Did he have a weapon in his hand when he barged through the door?
Yes, he did.
Describe that weapon.
It was some sort of jack.
Dan suffered injuries to his face and neck. He says moments later, Kelly followed Gino home, where Gino turned his rage on her.
He attacked her in the garage. Essentially, was choking her. It was rather violent encounter.
Less than 2 months later, Kelly was murdered.
State goes Gino Rallo.
Gino Rallo testifies Sheila Trott was the master manipulator who taunted him into attacking Dan.
She would call me from time to time and say, hey, this is going on, and they're having an affair.
How many times was the defense calling you about this?
A lot.
Did you believe it at the time?
I did not.
Prosecutors say Sheila used emails to light Gino's fuse as well, but they also revealed her own deep-seated anger. In one email she wrote, he was sitting in front of you, lying to your face.
Were you hoping that Gino was going to go over and attack his wife or attack your husband, putting an end to this affair so you could have Dan back?
Oh, no. I wasn't upset that Dan was having an affair with Kelly. I was upset that he was spending the money that he was.
Still trying to prove no one was more upset than Gino, Sheila's attorneys want the jury to hear a voicemail that he left Dan 2 months before Kelly's murder.
You
But the judge refuses, declaring it irrelevant.
Gino's the only person who knew where Kelly specifically was that evening.
It sounds like you think Gino's the killer.
I'm not going to say who I think it is. Gino could absolutely do it. Kelly wanted out of that marriage.
Prosecutors say Gino has a strong alibi. They say the security video from a drugstore in another town proves Gino couldn't have been at the murder scene. And Kelly's next-door neighbor, Scott Vickers, testifies that he saw a blonde woman, not a man, on Kelly's lawn that night.
It was a light-colored outfit, which, you know, that's, or else I wouldn't have been able to really see, but it was some type of light outfit.
That light-colored outfit, detectives theorize, could be a reason why none of Kelly's blood was found on Sheila.
What do you think about their contention that you were wearing some sort of hazmat-like
suit?
That's
the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard. We're next to Disney World. Why didn't they just put me in a Mickey Mouse suit? Are you serious?
Things are about to get very serious at Sheila Trott's trial. Her two sons are about to take the stand against her. And what they have to say is another nightmare for their mother. In a tragedy that seems to know no bounds, Sheila Trott's two sons are about to testify at her murder trial. For the prosecution.
How are you related to her?
She's my mother.
And do you see her in the courtroom here today?
Yes.
With his mother watching and listening just 15 feet away, Graham Trott first describes helping her when she seemed to be having a seizure, the night Kelly Brennan was killed.
I picked her up and put her on the couch because she was hitting her head against the wall.
Prosecutor Samantha Barrett quickly cuts to the chase, asking him what happened after his mother came home from the hospital a few hours later.
She was telling me she was seeing things.
What did she say she saw?
She saw Kelly's face, and she said she thinks she's hurt at a beach.
Despite the prosecutor's efforts...
Did you ever hear her say, I think I hurt Kelly?
No.
Graham won't repeat what he initially told investigators in a recorded interview.
So I think I hurt Kelly. And I keep seeing her face, and then I hurt her. And I was like, well, that's not good.
But what he does reveal next is a bombshell, and it's something he did not tell law enforcement until shortly before the trial.
So do you want to drive down to this beach that you're seeing, and we can see there's nothing there, and then we can call it a night and go to sleep?
Sheila agreed, taking her sons Graham and Creighton and Graham's girlfriend on a macabre field trip to Mark's Landing. And there, with Sheila leading the way, the boys, 16 and 18 years old at the time, saw Kelly's bludgeoned body.
You could see, I mean, it was just a lifeless body just lying there.
Was your mother with you when you saw that?
Yes.
What did she say?
Nothing really. It was just in shock.
Why would you take your two teenage sons out to Mark's Landing and show them where the body was?
The kids took me.
You led them to that place.
I didn't take them right to the body. We walked around, and we were just on our way out when we saw her feet.
Why is it when your mother came over to the house, you didn't tell her, we just got back from Mark's Landing where we saw a dead body?
You'd have to ask the kids that. I don't know. It just never really came up. When my mother first came in there...
Didn't come up, Sheila. You'd just been to see a dead body, a woman whose skull was crushed.
Mm-hmm. Well, when my mom came in, I was in bed and she woke me up. I don't remember the conversation very well.
As inexplicable as that seems, the horror of the night didn't end there for Sheila's sons. She told them she also had visions of a nearby vacant lot. And that's where Creighton Trot tells the court they made a second damning discovery. A bag.
Mom opened it up. Went into the purse and saw, opened up the wallet, and we saw Kelly's driver's license.
What did you do next after you saw the bag with Kelly Brennan's driver's license in the wallet?
Told her that we didn't want to have anything to do with it, that me and Graham were going to go to sleep, and that she had to deal with it on her own.
How important are these boys to your case?
Their testimony is absolutely critical. It seemed that they... were determined to do what was really the right thing and tell the truth.
Sir, you're free to go.
After her son's scathing testimony, Sheila's defense team faces a huge uphill battle. They try to poke holes in the forensic evidence gathered at Mark's Landing.
Well, we know that Kelly's body comes out of the car and comes down this way, and we know that because there's blood transfer found on this pole right here.
Kelly's blood was on this very post.
Right.
The defense says, not so fast.
The spots on the fence post, and did you afford them for forensic testing?
They were not.
So as to whether those items are blood or a kid's red Slurpee, we're left to guess, right?
If you would like to put it that way.
And the defense tries to tear apart the alleged motive, that Sheila was jealous and murderously angry over her husband's affair with Kelly. Elizabeth McHugh was Sheila's divorce attorney. She says Sheila seemed fine with the affair.
She really didn't have a problem with Kelly because she knew her, and so she knew she would be very good with the children and wouldn't really be a problem in the divorce.
Okay.
Motive aside, Sheila's dream about Kelly lying hurt here at Mark's Landing and a field trip with her two sons here are among the strongest evidence against her. But there is a new twist to this tale. Sheila says that dream was actually a memory of witnessing Kelly being killed by a strange man.
She was arguing with him, and I heard him say, "But Kelly," and she said, "Enough." And then she went and bent into the car to do something, and I saw him hit her.
While behind bars awaiting trial, Sheila says that her memory has come back to her, and she's written a detailed account of what happened.
Then you write, "He dragged her into the grass and kept hitting her."
Mm-hmm.
Is that what you saw?
Yes.
Yes, and I didn't do anything.
You didn't call police, why not?
Sheila shared this memory in a letter to a friend. She claims that she had decided to stop at Kelly's house that night to ask Kelly to stop driving by her house looking for Dan. And at the exact moment she arrived, Sheila saw a strange man attack Kelly.
How would you describe this man who was with Kelly?
It was too dark. It was too dark.
This letter, prosecutors say this is a confession.
No, it's not a confession letter. That's my account of what happened that evening.
But Sheila's new account becomes even more bizarre. Instead of running for her life or to the nearest police station, she followed the stranger's car all the way to March Landing and watched him dispose of Kelly's body and belongings.
Do you understand, as you sit across from me right now, mm-hmm. that your story is a fantastic story? Mm-hmm. You follow the killer, mm-hmm. which doesn't make a lot of sense to anyone.
Mm-hmm.
And then you don't tell cops what happened, what unfolded. You don't even tell your own mother. All these things are consciousness of guilt, are they not?
Well, they're consciousness of guilt. Why would we call the police? If I committed this crime and I had killed her, I would have taken off. I'm not stupid enough to stick around.
Come to order, please.
And Sheila believes this new memory could set her free. But the question is, will the jury get to hear Sheila Trott's version of what happened the night Kelly Brennan was killed?
Is Sheila clairvoyant? Has she had visions throughout her life? Dreams that have come true?
I don't think so, Peter.
With her daughter's dream now being described as an eyewitness account of Kelly's murder, 48 Hours has brought Margaret a copy of that document Sheila wrote.
Do you recognize the handwriting on this letter?
Yes.
Whose is it?
Sheila's.
She reads, for the first time, from its 22 pages.
He dragged her into the grass and kept hitting her. I felt the blood rush out of my arms and legs, and I started to shake.
Are these the writings of an eyewitness to a murder, or the writings of a murderer describing what she has done?
I think she must have seen it. She couldn't have done it, Peter.
I did not murder Kelly. I witnessed it.
Now came the moment in court where Sheila Trott could take the stand and persuade the jury her new story is true. But on the advice of her attorneys...
First of all, have you made a decision about whether you wish to testify in your case or not?
Yes, sir.
What is your decision?
Not to, sir.
That you've chosen not to testify?
Yes, sir.
Sheila's first lawyer thinks he knows why Sheila didn't testify and explain that letter.
Obviously, this was just her confessing to the crime. She needed to get it off her chest.
Todd Derritani's a liar.
So the case goes straight to closing arguments, with prosecutors zeroing in on what Sheila did say after Kelly disappeared.
The smoking gun in this case are the defendant's own words, telling the police where the dead body is.
They play Margaret's damning 911 call one last time.
And my daughter has had a nervous breakdown, and she's saying she's killed somebody.
Your daughter's telling me she killed somebody?
Yes.
Defense attorneys make no mention of Sheila's new claim she saw Kelly's killer. Instead, they try to pick apart the state's case.
You're being asked to believe a 115-pound person is going to be able to pick up a 146-pound person, probably deceased at this point, and no pun intended, but there's no way. But she's going to pick her up from the floor, lift her up, and place her in the seat of not of a Honda Civic, but of an SUV. Place her in there. With no neighbors hearing a thing, no neighbors hearing blow after blow after blow. Does that make any logical sense?
They end by pointing the finger at Kelly's jealous husband.
She had no ill will, no spite, no evil intent, no premeditation. You saw the person. You heard from the person that had all those things
and how he acted on those feelings.
ladies and gentlemen, the decision you need to speak is that Sheila Grand Trotta is not guilty. Thank you.
Less than 3 hours after beginning their deliberations, jurors reach a verdict. Margaret can't wait to hear the good news.
I was dancing. I was dancing in the elevator. I was so excited because I knew, and I kept saying, we're going to bring our girl home.
Instead,
the defendant, Sheila Grand Trotta, is guilty of first-degree premeditated murder.
Guilty of first-degree murder. Sheila Trotta was immediately sentenced.
It's a sentence of the court that you serve life in prison as a minimum mandatory sentence.
For Margaret Byers, who wishes she never made that 911 call, the embers of blame burn deep within her heart.
You are a loving mother and grandmother, and you love Sheila dearly.
Yes.
Does it tear you up at night to think that I put my own daughter in jail?
Yes, it sure does. It just tears me up to think I put my kid in jail for the rest of her life. Absolutely.
Isn't it time for you to stop telling these stories and tell the truth? Mm-hmm. Don't let your loved ones suffer thinking that you're innocent when you did this.
Mm-hmm. I told the truth, and I'm continuing to tell the truth, and I'm going to keep telling the truth.
She killed Kelly Brennan. She's a murderer. She's finished. As well she should be.
For Kelly Brennan's mother, the taste of justice is bittersweet.
That's a tragedy of the family as well.
Almost 5 years after her death, Kelly's friend Lou says her kind spirit lives on.
When she did come to work, she was always happy and she had her little corner.
It was called Kelly's Corner, a place in the hospital where Kelly gave extra care and attention to her patients.
And even after she died, it was an area of reverence. If you went there, it was comforting.
Why shouldn't this audience believe you're just a clever sociopath? But you are a killer. You know the difference between right and wrong.
Yeah.
But in the case of Kelly Brennan, you don't care.
I do care. I do care. When would her body have been discovered? You said yourself, who led them to the body? It was us saying that it was at Mark's Landing. They would never have checked at Mark's Landing.
But despite leading her sons to Kelly's battered body and being found guilty by a jury of six, Sheila Trotta is unrepentant. The real killer, she insists, still walks free.
I have to live with a lot of guilt for not stopping the attack. Now I'm paying the price. And Kelly's family has closure, but they don't have justice. Because I didn't kill Kelly.
Sheila's sons, Creighton and Graham, told 48 Hours, "We unequivocally believe in our mother's innocence and stand by her." Sheila Trotta is appealing her conviction.
My story is evil. I was 19 years old. I was an absolute rocker.
Check.
A guy just came up and then, bam, he slammed a gun to my head and he gouged my eyes and he said, I'm gonna mutilate you and throw you down the cliffs. I fought with everything I had in my soul to not have a toe tag at the end.
We got him.
It's you, and I've caught you. You're gonna go down.
CBSN, the live digital news network from CBS News. Watch live anywhere, anytime. CBSN, CBS News, always on.